comfortable? Are you too scared to move and walk out of this tomb? Buried underneath the lies that you believe. You're safe and sound, stuck in the ground, too lost to be found. You're just asleep, and it's time to leave. Come on and rise up, take a breath, you're alive now. Can't you hear the voice of Jesus calling us out from the grave like Lazarus? Your brand new power and death couldn't hold you. Can't you hear the voice of Jesus calling us out from filled your veins was more than blood, is the kind of love that washes sin away. Now the door is open wide and the stone's been rolled aside. The old is gone, the light has come, so come on.
Just get this thing started. Heavenly Father, we come here this morning just in love and adoration to you and just in a desperate need of worship to you this morning. Lord, I just want to thank you for everything you're doing in this church and in our lives and in this community. And Lord, we feel your presence this morning, and we just thank you so much for just filling this space with your spirit. Lord, as we worship this morning, I hope that everything we do and all of our voices just bless your heart, and that you can just feel that we love you this morning. In your name, Father, we pray. Amen.
Times I fail, still your mercy remains. Should I stumble again, still I'm caught in your grace, everlasting. heart and my soul. Would I give you control? Consume me from the inside out, Lord. Let justice and praise become my embrace. To love you from the inside out. You will above all else, my purpose remains. The art of losing myself in bringing you praise everlasting. Your light will shine when all else fades, never ending. Your glory goes beyond all fame. My heart and my soul, will I give you control? Consume me from the inside out, Lord. Let justice and praise become my embrace. To love you from the inside out, everlasting. Your light will shine when all else fades, never ending. Your glory goes beyond all faith, and the cry shall I fear? You crush the enemy underneath my feet. You are my sword and shield, though troubles linger still. Whom shall I fear? I know who goes before me. I know who stands behind. Strength is in your name, for you alone can save. You will deliver me, yours is the victory. Whom shall I fear? Whom shall I fear? I know who goes before me. I know who stands behind. The God of angel armies is always by my side. The one who reigns forever, he is a friend of mine. The God of angel armies is always by my side. Nothing formed against me shall. The whole world in your hand. who goes before me. I know who stands behind. The God of angel armies is always by my side.
Bringing back the song of surrender, and just as we take a minute during this song to just place ourselves in a position of surrender, to know and to have the confidence that we can do that because He does stand for us, and whom shall we fear? And so with the confidence of what Christ has done for us, as we go into this next song, let's just, you know, open your palms, bow your head. You can sit down, you can kneel, you can go to the back and seek prayer. Whatever you need to do right now to just lay yourself at the feet of Christ.
Speak. to know you more. I want to know you more.
All right, good morning. Kids, real quick, before you leave for Kids Town, let's pray as a church for them. God, thank you for bringing us here this morning together to learn about you and hear your word, Lord. And we just pray that these kids and these leaders have a fun time learning about your love, God. And we just pray that you draw them close, draw them in this week, and just bless their time, Lord, as they learn about you and learn to love like you love us. Amen. All right, kids, find your leaders in the back. We got Andrew and Sammy, Lindy, I think. And yeah, head on back and greet each other, and we'll get our scripture reader going.
Make our way to our seats now, and we'll read scripture and start a sermon.
It's a good morning for it, apparently.
As I said a couple weeks ago, it was a church thing.
Yeah.
These used to be painfully awkward,
yeah.
At least like growing up. Right? And then it's like they just
actually
like love each other. Can you just stop loving each other? Thanks for doing the scripture reading too.
It's all set up.
All right, guys, reading from 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9. But you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, and a holy nation, God's special possession, that you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness and into his wonderful light. This is the word of our Lord.
Thank you, Brett. You guys can have a seat. He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Yeah, we might do that all year, by the way. Because what's true of Easter is true today. We live in resurrection reality. Jesus doesn't go back to the grave. We don't go back to just being miserable in our sorrow and our suffering. We still have hope because he's still alive. He is reigning and ruling, sitting beside the Father, till every enemy is made his footstool, and he's coming back to redeem, reunite, and renew heaven and earth. Amen?
Amen.
He's alive. He is risen. Well, welcome to Laurel Church. If this is your first time in a long time, or whether you're a lifer, we just are a community that's passionate about building a community that's built around Jesus. To do this, we want to intentionally spend time with Jesus. We want to be with Jesus. Have the desire to become like Jesus and walk in the Spirit's power to do the types of things that Jesus did. And as we focus on doing what Jesus did, this is the block that we're currently now entering into. We'll be talking about the kingdom of God. Because the primary thing that Jesus came to do 2,000 years ago was to inaugurate and establish the reign and rule of God on earth as it is in heaven. So this morning, we're starting a new 5-week teaching and practice series titled The Inbreaking Kingdom. But before we begin, let's get distracted slightly and pull up a short clip of one of my favorite inspirational sports movies ever, and it's called Miracle. Miracle is based on the true story of the 1980 U.S. hockey team upsetting the Soviets, who had the world's best goaltender. Now, that's the highlight. But the movie also shows the hard moments. how the U.S. hockey team struggled at first based off of its individualism and entitlement and how they lacked true team chemistry. They played as a bunch of individuals and not as a team. And so after a terrible exhibition game where they gave really bad effort, Coach Brooks kept the team on the ice and made them do conditioning for an hour. And this is where the clip comes in. I don't think there's any swear words. Please give me grace if there is. All of you guys are like, just joking.
Everybody get on that line. Hey. Again. Again. Perfect. Come on, Craig, blow the whistle. Again.
Michael Ruzioni! Went through Massachusetts!
Who do you play for?
Play for the United States of America!
That's all, gentlemen.
And they all throw up. It's awesome. Now, I love that. Coach Brooks made the Olympic team condition like they were a junior high team that was out of line until at least someone finally understood that they weren't just a bunch of individuals, but a team. And that they weren't just playing for the name on the back, their last names, but they were playing for the name on the front, US of A, their country. We started today's teaching with this example because when it comes to our faith, we have to understand that Jesus didn't just come to save a bunch of individuals. Rather, he came to call individuals into a community, into a kingdom. And in an age of individualism, having a robust kingdom theology where we practice our faith in community, where we actually see the people we're sitting next to as brothers and sisters, where we embrace both Jesus and the church, where we stick together as soldiers do in war, it will transform the way you follow Jesus. And it will equip you to do the types of things that Jesus did and still does through the Spirit. So this morning, we're going to spend our time flipping through the pages of our Bibles and tracing the story of God's kingdom from cover to cover. And then the next few weeks, we'll dive a little bit more specifically into each topic. So our teaching this morning, as we flip through the pages of our Bible, consists of four parts. Part one, creation. Part two, promise. Part three, Jesus. And part four, the church. Are you ready? Okay, cool. It wasn't convincing. Okay, let's do this. Part one, creation. Genesis 1, 26 through 27 says, "Then God said, let us make mankind in our image and in our likeness so that they may rule over the fish in the sea and the birds in the sky, over the livestock and all the wild animals and over all the creatures that move along the ground." So God created mankind in his own image. In the image of God, he created them. Male and female, he created them. And God blessed them. And God said to them, "Be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth and subdue it and have dominion." You see, back in ancient Near Eastern culture, the title image of God was only reserved for the people of power, for pharaohs, emperors, and kings. But the biblical telling of creation makes the radical and redemptive claim that all of humanity bears God's image. And what was humanity's original and intended purpose? To rule. Mankind was made to be God's authoritative extension to, as the biblical author puts it, have dominion. That's kingdom language. So God, King of the cosmos, chose to rule the world he had created through his humans, through his image bearers. Now, God didn't need to do this, but he wanted to do this. He wanted humanity to partner and co-rule with him for his image bearers to have the royal role of filling the earth with his glory. And as king, God gave a decree for his image bearers to uphold, and the decree went something like this. If you eat from this tree, from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, you shall surely die. Now keep in mind, this was the only thing God said that was off limits for Adam and Eve. Besides this single tree, he gave his royal image bearers the whole world to submit, to steward, and to cultivate. The only thing he asked was for them to submit to his reign and rule, to believe in his character and to obey his word, to trust that he, their creator and king, knows what's best for them. But that was the very truth that the devil, in the form of a serpent, sought to attack. So he approached Eve and Adam beside her and told the lie that God couldn't be trusted. And they bought it. They believed in the devil's deception. Now, what's interesting and oftentimes missed is that in Genesis 1, Adam and Eve were empowered to rule and reign over all the wild animals. But in Genesis 3, we read that a wild animal tried to assert his rule and reign over Adam and Eve. This means that the authority Adam and Eve were given to rule the world was usurped by and forfeited to the serpent. And as a result, the world that was meant to be filled with God's heavenly glory and goodness through his image bearers is now filled with sin and suffering and death because of the fall of man and the tyranny of the devil. But in the midst of the devil's deception, in the midst of mankind's betrayal, in the midst of the shame that found its way into the world that God called good, was a statement. A statement that humanity would hold on to for generation to generation to generation. Part 2, promise. God cursed the serpent and said to him, I will put enmity between you and the woman and between your offspring and hers. He will crush your head and you will strike his heel. He will crush your head. Now, head symbolizes honor, intercession, and it can symbolize authority. So in other words, God was telling Satan, there will be a human who will reclaim the role that you stole. He will win back the royal authority that humanity forfeited. He will reinsert God's reign and rule upon the earth, and you'll try to stop him, but you won't succeed. O serpent, your days are numbered. Now, this was the promise God made in the garden. A promise that began to take form when God would later call and make a covenant with Abraham. Now, just listen to the language God used when he called and made a covenant with Abraham. Genesis 12, I will make you into a great nation, and all peoples on earth will be blessed through you. Genesis 17, I will make you very fruitful. I will make nations of you, and kings will come from you. And later in Genesis 22, through your offspring, all nations on earth will be blessed because you have obeyed me. Now, these are just little snapshots of the conversations Yahweh would have with Abram. But just in those snapshots alone, God spoke of an offspring, a kingdom, and global blessing. We haven't even left the first book of the Bible, and God is already setting into motion the promise he made in Genesis 3. God is so faithful. Through Abraham and his offspring, God was working to reinsert his rule upon the earth through a set-apart community of image bearers and intercessors. This is why God told Israel in Exodus 19, although the whole earth is mine, Who does the earth belong to? Okay, I just feel like some of us needed that word this morning. God's in control. God says, though the whole earth is mine, you will be for me a kingdom of priests, a holy nation. So in this set-apart community that God called as a royal priesthood, God then renewed his garden promise to a man after his own heart. We know him as King David. And God said to David in 2 Samuel 7, when your days are over and you rest with your ancestors, I will raise up your offspring to succeed you. Your own flesh and blood, I will establish his kingdom. He is the one who will build a house for my name, and I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever. I will be his father, and he will be my son. Your house and your kingdom will endure forever before me. Your throne will be established forever. So first Adam and Eve hear of an offspring, then Abraham, and now David. But just to be clear, it wasn't David's son that this promise was ultimately referring to. Because though Solomon was given wisdom by God and built a temple for God, Solomon, if you know his story, he kind of fell and failed miserably. And it wasn't David's grandson that this promise was referring to as well. For though Rehoboam was David's flesh and blood, he acted pridefully by raising his country's taxes for the sake of his own ego, which led Israel to splitting into two kingdoms. So in just two short generations of kings, Israel went from hearing of an everlasting kingdom to experiencing heartbreaking division. And year after year after year, king came and a king went. And some kings honored God, but many kings strayed from God. Would the offspring promised to Eve and Adam, would the offspring, the descendant promised to David, ever be born? But 300 years later, when many may have forgotten or even forsaken God's garden promise, the Lord once again echoed what he spoke of in Eden. But this time he allowed a prophet named Isaiah to actually catch a glimpse of it. And after seeing it, Isaiah then wrote, "For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, and Mighty God, and Everlasting Father, and Prince of Peace." A child is born, and a son is given. Y'all, church, this is offspring language. The government will be on his shoulders. This is authority language. Isaiah actually caught a glimpse of the serpent-stomping human of promise that would inaugurate God's everlasting kingdom upon the earth by winning back the authority humanity forfeited in Eden. And he's coming. Part three, Jesus. What started out as a seemingly ordinary, quiet night suddenly took a turn for the better. An angel of the Lord appeared and announced to a group of lowly shepherds, "I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord." Eve's seed, Abraham's offspring, David's descendants, Isaiah's vision, Israel's king, and humanity's savior has been born. He's the one who will crush the serpent's head. He's the one who will reclaim our authority, reinsert God's rule upon the earth, forgive us of our rebellion, restore our relationship with himself, and reinstate humanity back to our original role of ruling alongside and interceding on behalf of God. Now that's a mouthful, but Jesus actually had one word that summed all of those angles of this scripture to scripture, cover to cover plot, and his one word of summary was this: kingdom. This is why in Mark 1 we read that Jesus came proclaiming the gospel of God and saying, the time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe in the gospel. Jesus proclaimed the good news of God's kingdom. In other words, Jesus went around proclaiming, there's a new ruler in town, a new kingdom at hand, a new era that's underway, a new way of thinking and living and relating to God and to others. So if you want in on this, if you want to enter into God's kingdom, enter into new creation, then repent and believe. In other words, denounce your allegiance to Satan and self and announce a new allegiance to God and his kingdom. This is why after delivering the demonized, Jesus declared in Matthew 12, if it is by the Spirit of God that I drive out demons, then the kingdom of God has come upon you. Now, Israel had the expectation that the Messiah, the human of promise, would set up God's kingdom by driving out their physical enemies, which at that time was Rome. But Jesus here didn't mention Rome. He spoke of demons. You see, Jesus came to push back and prevail against our spiritual enemies, the domain of darkness, the unseen powers and principalities that has held humanity captive ever since Genesis 3. Oh, Jesus was doing a work. So according to Jesus in Matthew 12, whenever we see evil overwhelmed and driven out by the Holy Spirit, bringing freedom and healing and redemption to the once spiritually enslaved, afflicted, and oppressed, the kingdom of God is at hand. The kingdom of God is in our midst. Heaven's realm has literally broken into earth's realm. The inauguration and establishment of God's inbreaking kingdom on earth as it is in heaven, that was the message Jesus proclaimed, the ministry Jesus performed, and the mission Jesus was determined to complete. And in his final days, as he set his face on Jerusalem to the place where he'd be exalted, not on a throne, but exalted upon a cross, Jesus uttered his battle cry. Now is the judgment of this world. Now will the ruler of this world be cast out. Wait a minute. What were humans originally created to do through God's rule? Rule. What did Jesus just call Satan? Ruler. So what was Jesus doing? Jesus was casting out and conquering the serpent who usurped Adam and Eve in order to win back that which was lost. Our identity, our authority, our original God-given purpose. Or as John would later put it, in 1 John 3:8, the reason the Son of God appeared was to destroy the works of the devil. And it was through our Lord's life in the flesh, his death on a cross, and his resurrection from the grave that the devil's works were indeed destroyed and his power stripped. Jesus himself said in Revelation 1:17, I am the living one. I was dead, and now look, I am alive forever and ever, and I hold the keys of death and Hades. Now, keys in the biblical narrative symbolizes authority. This means that Jesus, the Christ, the one who died and rose again, he triumphed over human evil. He won a decisive victory over the devil, and he has overpowered death itself. As Paul said in 1 Corinthians 15, where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? And this is why Jesus said in Matthew 28, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Christ Jesus, the divine human, has won back and reclaimed on behalf of humanity the authority to partner with and co-rule alongside God in his kingdom on earth as it is in heaven once more. Which explains why Jesus, right after saying that he has all authority in heaven and on earth, then commissions his followers to go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you, and surely I am with you always, to the very end of the age. Part four of the church. You see, the authority Jesus won back, he gave back. To all the young parents in the room, that's a risky move, right? You take back a toy that you gave your kid because your kid was hitting another kid on the head with that toy, and then you give back that toy? Whoa. We lost this authority. Jesus won it back, and he is so gracious and generous, he wants to share it with us again. He won it back, and he gave it back at that particular time to his small group of followers. He prepared them for this after his resurrection when he breathed on them, saying, "Receive the Holy Spirit." Then after his ascension on the day of Pentecost, the authority that was promised was given as the Holy Spirit was poured out, baptizing them in power. Now, by the grace of God, through the Holy Spirit, in the name and in the authority of King Jesus, every follower of Christ is empowered to share the good news of God's kingdom. And the good news of God's kingdom includes what we are saved from and what we are saved for. Now, here's what we're saved from. Paul puts it beautifully and really succinctly in Colossians 1. Verses 13 through 14, he says that God in the person of Christ, he has rescued us from the dominion of darkness and brought us into the kingdom of the Son he loves, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. And many stop there. But what are we saved for? What are we called to disciple others into? Peter described it well, and Brett so beautifully read it earlier. But you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for his own possession, that you may, that speaks of purpose, that you may proclaim the excellencies of him who called you out of darkness, what we're saved from, into his marvelous light. Church, do you know who you are? Do you know who you are? You are more than a wretched sinner that God has to put up with in order to keep his reputation of love afloat. You are more to him than that. He loves you. Because of his love for you, God himself put on flesh to become like us and actually one of us. Because of his love for you, God himself carried and condemned our sin in his own body. Because of his love for you, God himself descended to the place of the dead to rescue the righteous from darkness. Because of his love for you, he has redeemed you to be a chosen, holy, royal priesthood. God doesn't just put up with you. And I don't know who that's for, but that has been resounding in my heart all week this week. God isn't just putting up with you. You are so important to him. He loves you. And he speaks a new identity over you, and he invites you to participate in the priesthood. Which brings me to my next question. Do you know the power you have, church? Do you know who you are, and do you know the power you have in Christ? Jesus alone accomplished perfectly his kingly and priestly assignment. The assignment Adam and Eve was once tasked with, he completes. And then he graciously assigns it back to us, the people of God. And along with our assignment comes his authority. Remember how keys symbolize authority in the biblical narrative? Jesus told his disciples in Matthew 16, "I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven." Whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. He shared his keys with us. How many of you guys lose your keys, like, every day? Don't lose these keys, okay? Church, do we believe this? Do we believe that we, the people of God who are in Christ Jesus, have the power to resist temptation? That we have the power in the Holy Spirit to overcome addiction. That we have the power to loosen strongholds, to dethrone principalities, to cast out demons, to preach good news to the poor, and to declare freedom over the captives. Do you believe that he who is in you is greater than he who is in the world? Do you believe that you are empowered and equipped by the Holy Spirit to stand against the schemes of the enemy and to see the gates of hell not even stand because of the redemptive power of the church? Do you believe that your prayers contain heavenly power to reshape lives and schools and whole communities? An old dead guy named Karl Barth, he once said, to clasp the hands in prayer is the beginning of an uprising against the disorder and the chaos of this world. 2 Timothy 2:11 says, if we died with him, Jesus, we will also live with him. If we endure, we will also reign with him. Now, church, I hate to break it to you, but the Bible doesn't end with individual souls floating away to a distant and disembodied heaven where we get to play the harp with cute and chubby baby angels. Though the paintings are rad and a little creepy, that's not actually how the Bible ends. The Bible ends with heaven and earth, body and soul, reunited and renewed. It ends with the coming kingdom coming to earth. It ends with the consummation of what Jesus inaugurated by his death and resurrection. It ends with the saints who are co-inheritors with Christ, reigning alongside Christ. Amen. Come, Lord Jesus, come. Revelation 5, 9 through 10 says, and they sang a new song, saying, you are worthy to take the scroll and to open its seals, because you were slain, and with your blood you purchased for God persons from every tribe and language and people and nation. You have made them to be a kingdom and priests to serve our God, and they will reign on earth. Revelation 22:5, and there will no longer be any night, and they will not have need of the light of a lamp nor the light of the sun, because the Lord God will illumine them, and they will reign forever and ever. This is the culmination, the telos of our story. Now, in this present age, there is sin and suffering and sickness and death. But in the age to come, there will only be life, life eternal and life abundant. Amen. In the age to come, there will only be the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, and God's holy people. Evil will finally and fully be judged and eradicated, and there will only be righteousness and justice that flows from his throne. Amen. The kingdom of darkness will literally be swallowed up, and the kingdom of light and love will last forever. Now, for those of you who haven't yet given your allegiance to King Jesus, do you want to? Do you want in on this? For today, as the scriptures say, is the day of salvation. No matter what you've done in the past, there is pardon for your sin because our King is gracious. And there's a whole kingdom and priesthood that awaits you. So as Jesus simply said, repent and believe in the good news of the kingdom today. And to all those who have given your lives, your allegiance to King Jesus, I've already spoken today of your identity and have spoken about your authority, but I just want to end with a quick word about your community. Again, I think we've all embraced what we're saved from. We're saved from the grip of Satan. We're saved from the power of evil. We are saved from the wages of sin, which is irreversible and everlasting death, a death that people choose for themselves based on the refusal to come to Jesus for life. We know we're saved from all that, but have we embraced what we're saved for? Have we just wanted people to say the sinner's prayer and then peace out? Let's go save another one and leave them hanging, having no idea what they're saved for. Have we embraced that we're saved for and brought into a kingdom? The kingdom of heaven, which is the royal and redeemed community of God. Because of the messiness of people, because of the brokenness of the church on this side of resurrection, the hurt caused by church leaders, or maybe because of the age of individualism that has discipled you, many Christians have attempted to separate the inseparable. Many Christians have attempted to separate Jesus from the church. We want Jesus. I'm a Jesus person, but I don't want the church. I'm just not really into going to church. I want Jesus, but church? Nah, I'll pass. They're a bunch of hypocrites or whatever. But to separate Jesus from the church, to pick one and not the other, that's like choosing a head without a body, or a big brother without the siblings, or a marriage without a spouse, or a king without a kingdom. And the body, the family, a marriage, and a kingdom are all pictures of Christ's union with his people. You enter union with him. Again, I hate to break it to you, that also means finding solidarity with your brothers and sisters. We know what we're saved from, but do we know what we're saved for, what we're entering into? We're entering into a kingdom. And so this week's practice is simply to press into the community you call church, the community we call family. Press into community. If you're introverted, Remember, we're all going to be in heaven one day. Actually, in the new heaven and new earth. And we're going to be with each other. Forever. I recharge by getting away from people. Can't escape me! That's for the introvert. For the extroverts, we're going to love heaven. Okay. On a more serious note, if this morning you find yourself going rogue, if you find yourself a lone wolf, if you find yourself isolated, you're a Jesus guy or a Jesus girl, but church, I don't really know. I'm pleading with you to re-enter into community, to not just choose the king, but to choose the community that the king gave his life for. To be a part of the church. That might look like, if you haven't been to your community group in a while, re-enter your community group this week. If you haven't been to a Laurel community group, swing by the welcome booth in the lobby, pick up a flyer. We meet on Tuesdays, Wednesdays, Fridays. Okay, we have a men's breakfast once a month, the first Saturday of each month from 7 to 8:45, not 8:46, 8:45. Just joking, we've gone to like 10 before. Join a Laurel community group. Re-enter into community. Don't give up on the church. Maybe for some of you, you've been hurt, burned, frustrated, and never really felt like people saw eye to eye with you. And instead of fuming in frustration, instead of stewing in your pain, call someone up. Have a conversation. Seek someone that you know what? It would be really good to re-enter into relationship and to take active steps of reconciliation with this person. Just give them a phone call. Amen. Schedule a time for a cup of coffee or tea. Begin the conversation. If for some of you, you're a little bit leery of church because of, honestly, the stories you've been told, what you've seen, the hypocrisy you felt, yada, yada, yada. Just remember, Jesus came to save the sick, not the healthy. Jesus came to give his life for broken people because that's all the people there were and was and is for him to give his life to. We all need a savior. The world needs a savior. And guess what? Maybe you should stop judging the church so harshly because the church are just a group of people that recognize, I need a savior. I need help. I need healing. I need restoration for my mind and my soul and my body. I need Jesus. So whatever the reason, I am commissioning you, re-enter into community. Worship team, you can come back up. Maybe for some of you, you feel like you were going through the trial, you're going through the stuff, you're going through the trenches, you were grieving and mourning and hurting and broken. You need community more than ever before. You are not meant to navigate through the sufferings of this world alone. Let your brother hold you up. Let your sister hold you up. I'm reminded of the arms of Moses, how he had his two brothers, his Aaron and her, and he had brothers lift his arm up because as long as his arms were up holding the staff, Israel was winning their battle, but he needed help propping his arms up. Don't try to hold your staff by yourself. Let a brother help you. Let a sister help you. We need each other. You keep logs in a fire, the fire goes. You kick a log out of the fire, what once was a hot log is going to die out quicker. We need community, especially if you're going through what I just call, quote unquote, the stuff. We need each other. Let's not choose Jesus and try to separate Jesus from the church. Let's not try to be all about a king without the kingdom community he's brought and he's bringing people into. Jesus didn't come to save a bunch of individuals. He came to make individuals friends and friends into family and family into kingdom, that he could give back the authority he reclaimed so that we could partner with and rule alongside God and amongst each other. For his glory, for his purposes, for his power, for his beauty. All for King Jesus. Church, if you're able, if you're willing, can you please stand with me and receive a benediction? We have one more song, and after I read this benediction and we sing this song, I want to invite you guys maybe right now to practice community. I would encourage you with this. Simply extend out your palms with an open hand, which helps posture your spirit to be open. And just ask God, God, is there anybody that you want to encourage this morning? And what is that word of encouragement? Maybe right now, during this song, we can move around and just encourage each other. Just give each other a hug. A high five, a short prayer, a word of encouragement. If you need prayer, we have two prayer corners. We have a prayer corner in the back and a prayer corner in the front. I'll be at one, and I guarantee you, someone from staff, someone from our board, someone who just loves this church will meet you in that corner in the back or in the front and just pray with you. I hope that maybe you felt like an individual heading in here, but that you leave knowing you're part of a family, you're part of a kingdom, you're part of something bigger than yourself. So here's the benediction. To him who loves us and has freed us from our sins by his blood and has made us to be a kingdom and priests to serve his God and Father, to him be glory and power forever and ever. And the church, the embassy of the kingdom, says, amen. Peace be with you.
see what you see. I'm not in a hurry when it comes to your spirit, when it comes to your presence, when it comes to your voice. I'm learning to listen, just to rest in your nearness. I'm starting to notice you are speaking. Lord, I don't want to rush on ahead in my own strength. When it comes to your presence, when it comes to your voice.